Hello, I'm Naveen, the Program Operations Director for Shelter Team at Make a Difference, and today we're going to be looking at specific learning disabilities. So give me some context about why specific learning disabilities. So as a program manager, as part of the shelter team, so I've gotten access to getting to know about the operation that's happening in shelters and getting to understand about 3,000 odd children that we're working with at shelters. And during this journey, like, one interesting thing that struck me is that I got to know that even children who don't have any challenges often get termed as dyslexic. Or say, for example, even when children show any characteristics of them having the learning disability, often it's again misunderstood as dyslexia. So dyslexia is not the only form of learning disability. So this presentation is going to give you some context about what are the different types of learning disabilities and how can we even identify children with these learning disabilities. So first, what are specific learning disabilities? So the term specific learning disability means a disorder in one or more basic psychological processes that a child takes to process, to either say talk, read, write, speak and spell, or even do mathematical calculations. So the causes of specific learning disabilities, if you look at it, it primarily has to do with a lot to how the brain is wired. So the major causes of the first one could be genetics. So it is primarily genetical that, say for example, if one of the child's parents or family members have a learning disability problem, there's high possibility that the child may also have a learning disability challenge. The next is injury to the fetus. So even when the child is not born, if the mother goes through any injury during the pregnancy period, this can also cause a challenge of how the child's mental development is taking progress, and this is again a major reason for how children get learning disability. Then having medical problems the mother had during pregnancy, parental usage of drugs, alcohol and nicotine, and again during pregnancy or before pregnancy, and lead poisoning, also premature birth, low weight birth and also birth trauma, all these constitute to how a child is developed when they are in the premature states. Right? So all these again cause a major factor of how learning disability is coming across. And the other two reasons are head injury and poor nutrition. So poor nutrition is again a major cause, especially with the children we are working with. Again, being in shelters, we don't know how the children's nutrition is at the shelter homes. So this may also have a significant amount of challenge where the child goes through these challenges, and that's one of the reasons why learning disability occurs in these children. So going forward, how can you identify children with learning disability? What are the characteristics that just by looking at them or identifying their behaviors, you can tell that these children may have learning disabilities? To again clarify, these are only characteristics that might give you a clarity towards they may or may not have, but it doesn't mean just because a child shows one or two instances, it means that the child has learning disability. Or even say, for example, if a child exhibits all of the points that's going to be shown, it again doesn't mean the severity of learning disability is really high. Right? So the first one, has reading, writing or maths achievement that are significantly below the child's capacity level. For example, the child when you talk to seems very intelligent, is very mature in the way they do their actions, but then when it comes to them putting their words in paper or when they try to explain it by just reading something, they may not be doing well. This may also be they may not relate to mathematics better, or they may not understand the concept of time and money easily. So these are some major ways how you can differentiate how the children have learning disability. The next one is they have a tight or awkward pencil grip, and the way how they sit when they write also shows that they may be going through this particular challenge. Next, illegible writing, because they are not able to process what they are writing exactly, or they often misspell the words that they are writing. This also is another reason why their handwriting is very bad. Right? They tire very quickly while writing, because again it takes a lot of physical and mental stress on them even just to think and process what they are writing. So they get into fatigue very easily. Saying words out loud while writing. So this helps them focus on the task that they are doing and helps them even focus on what they are writing. So this is again very common in children who have learning disability, where they keep telling out loud what they are writing, or very loud when they read stuff as well. Unfinished or omitted words in sentences, again they are not able to process till which word they have completed or what is the spelling of stuff. Right? So that's another major reason of how we can identify what these children are going through. And difficulty organizing thoughts on paper. Probably they may be easy to tell you what they feel, but the minute you ask them to write it down in a paper, they might completely write something different from what they tried explaining to you. and they have poor listening skills where they are not able to follow simple instructions that you ask them to follow. Or in worst cases, when you give them two sets of instructions which is following each other, they may not be able to comprehend what needs to go when. And the other one is they have trouble following instructions, right? So the other reasons are also sometimes they have awkward, clumsy, or at times immature behaviors or actions which they exhibit. And procedures, reversals and rotations of words. This is also very common. For example, they confuse between the word B and a D, or P and Q, or even mistake a plus sign for an X. Right, so this is how children with learning disability might see the words in their books. And they also have difficulty in catching, throwing or kicking balls because they're not able to see these objects as they are, and also have difficulty in carrying out one or more instructions. The other major thing is also they confuse often between left and right. For example, you might often see them wearing a left shoe on their right foot. Or even, you know, like confusing which direction they need to go to when you give them a very simple instruction saying, please take left. So the last one is difficulty in remembering anything in sequential order, for example, the weeks, the months, or even the tables, for example. So these are primary characteristics of how you can identify if certain children have learning disabilities. So the next one, So the other one is they also have challenges in pronouncing bisyllable words. For example, instead of the word hospital, they might spell it as hopital. Right, so it's very difficult for them to even place the words where it has to be, and they also show very slowness in completing tasks, irrespective of giving them a longer duration to explain the same thing. Right, so these being the common characteristics, let's quickly look at the other types of learning disabilities. So the most three common specific learning disabilities are one, dyslexia, second one, dyscalculia, and the last one is dysgraphia. Right? So we'll slowly explore each one. So the first one is dyslexia, which is a specific learning disability pertaining to reading. Right? So the children may have challenges in reading comprehension, spelling, and also writing at certain instances. So what are the characteristics of children who have specific dyslexia problems? So first, they have difficulty in recognizing the letter of the alphabet. As mentioned earlier, they might think B to be a D. Right? The next is difficulty in reading text or a passage because they often can't see the words in the place they are, and they keep jumbling between words or even letters in the particular passage. Next, they produce reversals and rotations as explained earlier. And they have difficulty in pronouncing multisyllabic words, example hospital. Right? They also have an average articulation skill, but then when it comes to reading or writing, they are below average. The last one is they learn best when they are learned through hand gestures or experiments or direct hands-on experience, and they try to avoid anything that has to do with reading. So they are very good with visual cues, they are very good with listening, they might be even very good with doing things by making them experiment with stuff, but the minute they get into an environment where they read and understand something, they usually try to move away from this. So these are examples of characteristics that children might possess which relate to dyslexia directly. So the next one, dyscalculia. So dyscalculia is again difficulty with arithmetic or comprehending numbers in general, or even understanding how the facts in mathematics are in play. Right? So the characteristic of dyscalculia would be they make silly mistakes when writing, reading or recalling any type of numbers and additions or subtractions. It's very difficult. The next one is the results of addition, subtraction, multiplication or division are not always the same. Even if you give the same numbers again and again, they might come up with different answers every single time. Right? The next is they have poor mental math ability. They might want to sit for a longer time, do everything on a paper and try to figure out the number rather than just crossing even smaller numbers by their mental ability. And also, they are very poor with money and time. Right? And the inability to grasp and remember maths concepts, rules, formula, sequence, and basic addition subtractions also constitute these. For example, it's easy to tell like 2 into 2 is 4 and everything just is an addition of 2. Even if it's not told in the terms of multiplication, but instead in the terms of addition, which might be simple enough, they still find it very difficult to understand these examples. Right? They also have difficulty with abstract concepts of time and direction. So even again, the challenge of which side to take or where a point starts and where the point ends is often very difficult for these children to comprehend. And difficulties in games that involve mathematical computations like playing cards or board games where they need to keep track of the money that they play with or whose turn it is going to be next also is slightly difficult for these children to remember. So difficulty remembering dance steps or any sequence that needs to be followed is again would be a challenge. And difficulty keeping score during games. So these are some examples of what the children might be going through if they have dyscalculia, right? Next is dysgraphia. So dysgraphia is usually a transcription disability, which is basically they make mistakes when they try to write or their orthographic coding or finger sequencing. So finger sequencing is basically how they even move their hand to write certain words, right? So the characteristics of dysgraphia are generally illegible handwriting. You usually can't understand what they even write. Incorrect directionality of letters. For example, a P might be again turned into a D. And mixtures of prints or cursive, upper and lowercase, or irregular shape, size, or slant of letters. So even if you give them a notebook with borders to write between them, they find it very difficult to write within those borders. And unfinished words or letters, and they often omit words as well. And inconsistent position on page with respect to lines and margins. And inconsistent space between words and letters. So again, because they're not able to relate to where their words are going, or they're not able to handle how their hand movement is working, they find it very difficult to do this as well. They also have tight, awkward, or cramped or unusual grip when writing or holding a pen, and even their wrist motion might be very awkward when they try to write. Right? The other examples are they get exhausted due to writing, they have a strange body position, and taking a self-writing or carefully watching the hand that is writing. So again, they tend to watch what they are writing or their hand position because they are more focused on how their hand is moving or what they are trying to write rather than the content that is being written there. So this also helps, you know, this also results in them taking a longer duration to complete any given written task. So how are assessments done for specific learning disabilities? So again, there are various methods that are being followed right now. But again, I've not ventured into the methods, but rather what would be the steps in any assessment that's done for a child who's going through a learning disability. The first one is a review of all the educational records. It's very important for us to understand how the child has been performing in their school curriculum, even to understand what are the challenges they might be facing. It's also true that the child has to be at least the age of 7 by the time we understand if the child actually has a learning disability, because it takes us that much of records that we need to see how much the child has been progressing. The second, the observation of the child itself, putting them in a controlled environment and see how they work with certain things. And then the review of child's work, probably their homework, their drawings, and how they usually write. Medical vision and hearing examination, just to rule out the fact that they either have a direct challenge with even vision or their hearing. Developmental and social history, or how they have interactions with their peers. Final gross motor evaluation, which helps them in motion, their writing and their hand movements and gestures. The adaptive behavior. Their speech and language assessment, the way they are able to talk, or if they have a barrier with the language that where they are studying. For example, children usually fare better in their mother tongue than being asked to talk in English. So even they test out for that, this also to rule out the possibility of just being a language difficulty. And also intellectual ability or the IQ tests, the assessment of academic skills of where they are right now and where how much they are able to perform well, and also social and emotional assessments. So this is again pertaining to how their interactions with their peers would be. Behavioral assessment, psychiatric evaluation would be the last step where they have a proper evaluation with the psychiatrist, and then they are either termed they are having a learning disability or not. Right. So why is timely diagnosis important right now with the children that we work with or any child who has learning disability? So it is recommended that the child, when they are in this primary school itself, they get the support that they require, and any primitive steps need to be taken. The fact is also because as of now the understanding is above the age of 12, the development level of the brain slowly starts reducing. So any time if we go after this, it's either very difficult for us to help the child directly, or even takes us very long to start this procedure. So it's very important that when the child is in the primary school itself, we identify this and get to them early on. Right? So the next step is how, as teachers, we can help with the child and how it would help them in also being in a very comfortable environment. So the first thing is, by knowing all there is to know about learning disabilities. So as a teacher, the first thing you need to know is not all disabilities are the same. Right? So even in learning disabilities, there are various other types. Like a couple of other points could also be like the child might even be suffering from ADHD, which is again pretty common. Right? So it's very important for any teacher to understand the differences and what are the characteristics exhibited by the child, and then have a proper evaluation done before judging what the child might be going through. Next, being perceptive and empathetic to the fact that the learning styles differ from child to child. not every child would learn the same way that every child would want to. And the other one is also setting up a learning environment that supports different learning styles. For example, certain children learn better with visual cues, or certain people with a writing or a verbal object, or even physically, right? So it's very important when any class is being conducted, it's important that you have all different styles of teaching, which will again help all the children to learn together. And the last one is knowing the correct time to intervene when learning becomes difficult, because unless you know when the child needs proper support, it again becomes very difficult to support them earlier. So that being said, so that is pretty much about learning disabilities in children right now, and these are three common brackets that are there. So I end my topic here. Thank you.